Now it's my great pleasure to introduce Gary Paul Nabhan. He is the W.K. Kellogg Endowed Chair in Borderland Food Systems at the Southwest Center in the College of Social and Behavioral Sciences. Gary received his bachelor's degree in environmental biology at Prescott College, his master's of science in plant biology at plant sciences at the University of Arizona, and his PhD in arid lands resource sciences at the University of Arizona. He is an internationally known agroecologist, a conservation biologist, an ethnobotanist, and a food systems designer. And on the side, he is a farmer. He has an orchard. He is a wild food forager, and he is also someone who does habitat restoration for pollinators of various types. He is well known locally for co-founding Native Seed Search, for the key role that he played in the establishment of the Ironwood National Ironwood Forest National Monument, for his work in the preservation of seeds and for setting aside reserves for the conservation of wild plants. And he's also a senior contributor to Edible Baja, the new magazine on food in our region. Gary is internationally known for nature writing, for his work in food and farming activism, and for his efforts to show everyone that biodiversity and cultural diversity are intimately linked to one another. In that area, he has worked very closely with ranchers, indigenous peoples, environmentalists, and farmers to bring them together to preserve the environment and to create sustainable food systems. And his most recent book, in fact, and I say most recent book, Gary writes about a book a year, so if you're watching a year from now, I'm sure there will be another recent book, is co-edited with Susan Charnley and his colleague in the Southwest Center, Tom Sheridan. It's called Stitching Together the West, and it's available here in our lobby and, as they say, at better bookstores. Speaking of books, Gary's written 27 books. They cover topics like desert terroir, landscapes, food cultures, food movements, insects, the big pollinators, cactuses, chilies, spices, tequilas, you name it, he's written on it if it has anything to do with food. The books have been translated into 6 languages and they are read by thousands, if not millions of people. His work is celebrated by the New York Times, by the Los Angeles Times, by Time Magazine, by the Utney Reader. He's gotten awards from so many different groups, too many to mention. MacArthur Genius Award, just to mention one. But for those foodies, you'll like to know that his work has been endorsed by none other than the likes of Alice Waters and Rick Bayless and Diana Kennedy. So he's you're in very good company here tonight. Let me welcome Gary Paul Nabhan, one of the country's most important public intellectuals around the area of food, and he's here at the University of Arizona. Gary?
Thank you. Thank you, my friend. Appreciate it. Greetings, Earthlings. I first off want to dedicate this talk to my Native Seed Search co-founder, Barney Burns, who passed away within the last few weeks and was someone who is beloved in this community. And so I can't talk about foods and seeds without having Barney in my heart tonight. So just wanted to acknowledge the great work that he did for this community and all of the Southwest. Happy World Food Day. And I've had a couple concussions this year, but if I remember right, World Food Day is that thing about close your eyes and visualize world peace. And we're prematurely celebrating what I think is going to be a major contribution to international recognition for Tucson. We're nominated for a UNESCO City of Gastronomy designation that we'll hear about within the next 2 weeks. We didn't know how close this lecture would be till the date that the announcement was going to be made. We think it'll be within the next 10 days or so. But rather than talking about what that designation might do for Tucson, I'd like to talk to you about how I think we're really worthy of that kind of international recognition because of the wonderful things that are already happening in this community. I was just up with my mother in Metro Phoenix, and she said, "Well, what are you working on now, son?" And I said, "Well, I'm working with the mayor and the Santa Cruz Valley Heritage Alliance and people in the university on declaring Tucson a city of gastronomy." And she said, "Oh, that's really too bad. Is it like Ebola virus or something?" And I said, "No, it's not. It's not that kind of declaration. It's." And she said, "Well, tell those people, if there's that many people with stomach aches down in Tucson, to try this Zantac. It's a lot better than Rolaids." So this sort of, you know, indicated to me that we're going to have to do a little bit of explaining for people to get the sense of what a city of gastronomy is and how being part of a UNESCO Creative Cities Network isn't black helicopters descending on Tucson like apparently they've descended on every other part of the state when we were sleeping, but that this is really something that galvanizes the interest of many professionals in this city to take pride in our agricultural and culinary heritage. So with that introduction, let me remind you that why we're worthy of such an international recognition is this peculiar combination of deep antiquity, one of the three landscapes north of the Mexican border, with the oldest agricultural remains of any place in North America, but incredible continuity with those traditions. We're the only metro area that's had continuation since the very first agriculturalist on through into historic and modern times. And that this is not just a retro recognition, but it's also about the incredible amount of innovation and vitality that I feel every time I come downtown anymore. I think we have over 12 new local food-oriented restaurants, as well as many older restaurants that are doing things that are just as fantastic and as creative as the newcomers. And that this has brought literally tens of thousands of people downtown for an entire evening, like we saw just a couple weekends ago with Tucson Meet Yourself and the Saturday Night Downtown events. And there's an incredible amount of excitement being generated with just what's happening within a few blocks of here. And that's just a start. This kind of innovation goes out to what the farmers and ranchers are doing in the food shed or the food providing area around Tucson that I'll talk about in a moment. So antiquity, continuity, and innovation are all packed together in a very unique way here. Now, let's talk about the antiquity first. Jonathan Mabry's here from the City Historic Preservation Office, and he's my coach on a lot of this, but within the Tucson Basin, we have some of the oldest corn and squash remains, as well as some of the oldest irrigation canal remains. I believe about 4 years ago, the ancient irrigation canals in Tucson were honored as being one of the 10 great recent discoveries in archaeology. And so there's a lot here that reminds us that we're in a very unique place and that people thousands of years ago recognized its uniqueness. The water coming out of the Catalina Mountains provided a steady flow of water into the bottomlands that farmers could harvest. It was at a scale that could match their skill set and their technology set. And from that, agriculture took off. There are sites with corn remains as old as those in Tucson, up near Zuni and up on the Hopi mesas. But something very special here, because we also have this development of irrigation agriculture that, as you know, now has led to the food production systems that we gain most of our agricultural harvest from in Arizona. So many of the first crops that were grown here were originally from places far to the south of us. This picture of caves, this is Gila Nakits down in Oaxaca, where Friends of Tucson's birthplace board members visited with us just a few weeks ago. And it's a remarkably similar climate and vegetation and cultural context as what we have in Arizona. The illustration there is a Native American rendition of what early agricultural water provisioning may have looked like. The point is, we have something very special here right in our midst that we need to celebrate, study, and educate people about. And there's many, many groups in the city and beyond that are doing just that. So that combination of antiquity, continuity, and innovation has resulted in unrivaled food diversity. We have more foods that are grown in the Tucson Basin in southern Arizona on the International Slow Food Arc of Taste than any other landscape in the Americas, period, from Tierra del Fuego up to Canada. And the kinds of wild foods that are still part of our food traditions here, like chiltepines and choya buds that you can now find even at farmers markets here after years, decades, and even centuries of being out of the marketplace, are now a vital part of what the incredible chefs in this town are experimenting with. But that diversity plays out in other ways. It's one of our buffers against climate uncertainty, because many of these are desert-adapted, drought- and heat-tolerant crops, as you know. And so it's not just that diversity has culinary significance that our chefs and cooks and, of course, eaters appreciate, but it also is part of the strategies that people are experimenting with in terms of adapting to climate uncertainty. But the innovation continues. I've been honored to be part of the development of native seed search since four of us in the early 80s, took the risk of forking out an enormous amount of money, I think $100 each, to get Native Seed Search incorporated. Native Seed Search has now distributed over 1 million seed packets, thousands of those back to Native American communities on both sides of the border, in some ways helping the Rarámuri or Tarahumara recover from their recent droughts because they lost their seeds. Hundreds and hundreds of pounds of seeds went back to them that varieties that they had lost during the drought of sequential years. And so a seed bank like Native Seed Search has played a very important role as a backup conservation system for farmers of all cultures and classes in the binational Southwest. But what I'm almost more proud of than Native Seed Search itself is how their staff, combined with the Tucson Pima County Public Library staff, just within the last 3 years, has created one of the largest community seed library networks in the country, where you can go into any library branch in the county, and those old card catalogs and the wooden frames, those beautiful cabinets that almost became obsolete when all the records for books were transferred to electronic platforms, digital platforms, Now those card catalogs are being used for seed packets. And we now have 30 outlets, 27 through the Tucson Pima County food system. Our little town where my wife and I live, Patagonia, has its own community seed library, as does Native Seed Search. I believe the Community Food Bank of Southern Arizona also has its free seed library. It's more like a seed saving and loan. You take a packet and you promise to bring back seeds after your harvest to replenish the stores. Those 30 seed libraries are 12% of all the seed libraries on the entire continent. And the kinds of innovation, the kinds of innovation in community outreach is even more exciting than the numbers. So what I'm saying here is the innovation on this public trust that we have, just like museums have a public trust to serve the communities where some of the items originally came from, has now really kicked in a very creative and wonderful way that people of any walk of life, of any economic class, can have some of the finest desert-adapted seeds to help them grow their own food rather than other options that may not be as attractive. It's not just about the seed diversity, though. We also have a diversity of agricultural landscapes in southern Arizona from where I studied for part of my dissertation at Quito Baquito Springs and Organ Pipe Cactus National Monument, where it was spring-fed irrigation and some of the fig and pomegranate trees that the Hiachida Autumn or San Papago people planted over a century ago still persist on those sites, to flood water or rainwater harvesting that Brad Lancaster and other people have renovated, to the remarkable work that Tohono O'odham Community Action is doing by renovating, innovating, and training participants to be young farmers on the Tohono O'odham Reservation, and many other kinds of interactions between the landscape itself and the water supplies that will hopefully make desert agriculture much more sustainable than it has been for most of the last century. So this is looking out over what Tucson looked at like right where we're sitting today from the vantage point of the office building on Tumamoc Hill that artist Paul Marocca and I share. This is what it looks like outside my window when I'm up on Tumamoc Hill, with a slightly different view in front of me now than what you see there. But all of that is embedded in the landscape itself. So we have these incredible contradictions and juxtapositions in our food-producing landscape. My friend Ken Meter from the Crossroads Center in Minnesota, who came down here to help the community food bank with the food systems economic assessment a few years ago, said when he came into the Tucson airport landing and looking out over the landscape, "Where's the farming?" And then when Nick and Jaime and other people on the food bank staff took him around, he says, "You can't see it from the air, but it is here." And so we have incredible juxtapositions of Las Milpillas Garden on the Santa Cruz in a place that basically lost its watering capacity 100 years ago with arroyo cutting, now being revived in places that have been vacant lots for most of the last quarter century. And you have this incredible mix of groups interested in being part of that revival, from interfaith groups to the food bank itself, to the wonderful programs that Sally Marston and Morgan Apicella do with the school gardens, with Moses Thompson and other people. These threads of a persistent agriculture are still in our midst, and people are working to weave them back into a cohesive quilt again. It's also true that where most of North America has lost its prehistoric and historic crop varieties and livestock breeds they remain here in our midst. Monday night at Overland Trout Restaurant down in Sonoyta, Dennis Maroney, the great rancher, shared the venue with Greg LaPrade, the chef there, and brought us Criollo Coriani cattle in four entrees, the same cattle breed that you see here that Padre Kino and other Spanish missionaries introduced by 1690 to this area. The many kinds of citrus that persist in Baja California, Sonora, and Arizona that Jesus Garcia and Rafael de Granada have studied, some varieties within 10 blocks of here that aren't in the USDA catalogs as citrus varieties being grown in the United States, still persist right here in our midst. Fig trees and pomegranate trees from the La Placida are now grafted and propagated and being offered by Desert Survivors Nursery. So we have this sort of chimerical thing where at one point this looks like a landscape that's all modern and devoid of agriculture, and yet there's deep roots like mycorrhizae spread out across the entire landscape in almost an invisible way. One of the most exciting things that I've been involved in the last few years is seeing a seed that Tom Sheridan and I collected from a couple farmers in Sonora, and Amadeo Ray collected from the widow of a wheat farmer near the Gila River, a revival of something that most agricultural scientists thought was dead by 1960, and that's white Sonora wheat, the oldest wheat variety introduced to the New World. It was called Candial wheats in the early Spanish documents. That's a soft white bread wheat. And we grew a small patch of it, maybe a third of the size of this auditorium, for years at Native Seed Search. No interest in it, sort of a museum piece. And then the boom in artisanal baking, wood-fired ovens, mixing different grains and doing slow fermentation of them exploded, and people like Don Guerra, who you see in the middle picture there, the great Barrio Breads baker who wakes up at 2 or 3 every morning to bring some of the greatest bread I've ever tasted to Tucson, and just jumped on it. He said, this is the kind of thing that I'm looking at to mix with other grains to do completely novel breads. The people on the right and left of Don are associated with Hayden Flour Mills. Our arch rival, Arizona State University, as you remember, is on Mill Avenue. That wasn't named for Haley Mills, it was named for the Hayden Flour Mills. And the Zimmerman family, Jeff, has gotten the rights to use the Hayden Flour Mills name for some of the greatest heritage wheat products that I've seen in a long time anywhere in the country, and is milling out of several places in the Metro Phoenix area. And now that wheat, after being out of the marketplace for over 50 years, is in something like 8 microbreweries, 30 restaurants, 15 farmers markets, and innumerable bakeries in the United States. And so some of these things sit like museum pieces until these innovators come and say, that's exactly what I'm looking for. And so the magic is this interaction between the growers, the millers, and the master bakers. And it's just been astonishing to see what they've done with items like this that were completely neglected. And the same can be said with the Criollo Coriani beef that is more tender and flavorful than any beef I've ever tasted. And so I guess what one of the messages of this talk is that there's a blessed ferment going on right now in Tucson in southern Arizona, that we have so many cultures, not just this truism of Native American, Hispanic, and Anglo, as if we only have three cultures here in Arizona. I'm sure Marty Bell will talk about that, and perhaps Diana did. But we've become this crossroads, this hub, where many different influences are interacting with one another. The Greek monks up in Pinal County that are making, growing astonishingly good olives and citrus, interacting with bakers in Coolidge, Arizona, Greek bakers that are using the desert grains in ways that local bakers have never thought of using them. And the same thing is happening in Bisbee and Tucson itself and Nogales. At the same time that we have all this innovation and admittedly high-value products being out into the marketplace again, we have to remember that the current marketplace does not work for everyone, and that we are still plagued in this community by high levels of poverty, food insecurity, outright hunger, and its ugly twin. Hunger has an ugly twin called obesity and nutrition-related diseases such as diabetes. And they have not left our communities. They probably were exacerbated since the economic downturn or the collapse or whatever you want to call it, because people were forced to make some poor food choices because of the austerity that they were living with that they would not have made otherwise. And so we have to remember that if we get a designation like this, it's not simply to encourage more tourism to Tucson, but we need to elevate from the bottom up the wages and the livelihoods and the capacity to regain health of the people who've been part of these traditions all along. And if we don't use this potential designation to do that, I believe we'll have failed. This is a graphic representation of what I'm talking about. This is the USDA food deserts map that was released about 4 years ago. And those big red blotches are designated food deserts now by USDA criteria. Now, if you look carefully at those maps, there are some strange anomalies like Davis-Monthan Air Force Base, which of course doesn't have grocery stores, but oddly enough, there's some truth to the fact that it's a food desert. The cafeteria food served at the base is not that great, not that healthy for our service women and men there. And Davis-Monthan, ironically, has some of the lowest pay levels for food service workers of any place in this city. Now, ask me why, I don't know, but when you go online and look for jobs for food service workers in Tucson, if you want an $8 an hour job with no tips, you can get it at Davis-Monthan, working in one of those cafeterias. Those are the kinds of people that we need to see helped by whatever we do with this potential declaration. The point is that over a century ago, the University of Arizona was established to help create greater self-sufficiency, prosperity, and adaptation to desert conditions. And it's still our mission. And we are trying across colleges, across departments, to deal with these very real problems that are still in our community. And with President Hart's commitment to 100% engagement of students in real issues in the community, this is one of the ones that we're really trying to take on. And Sally Marston and Morgan and Moses with this K-12 school garden and nutrition program is one of the ways that we're showing that the university's commitment is still here to solve the very immediate problems around campus. And so that map is one that we hope will change through time, and that those red problem areas will shrink as we use our expertise and talents and commitments within the university, along with Pima College and Prescott College and other institutions here, to really grapple the food insecurity here in our community. So again, how can we use this proposed designation that we hope we'll be hearing about in the next few weeks, Rolaids or no Rolaids, to alleviate poverty and to improve public health? One of the things that we've talked a lot about is that this food diversity that remains here in the region can be one of our strongest assets, that an apple is not an apple is not an apple. We have dozens of varieties of pomegranates, apples, figs, membrillos or quinces, each with different nutritional qualities and flavors and uses. And we need to bring those things back in full force in the 30-some farmers markets in southern Arizona and make sure that people with SNAP benefits can get some of the healthiest food, not some of the worst off-the-shelf food with this. And one of the things that we're working on as well is making sure that people know that they can purchase seedling seeds or live plants of fruit trees with their SNAP benefits so that they don't just get a single meal from going to the farmer's market, but the capacity to produce multiple meals. We also have to remember that, as Diana Liverman spoke about in this lecture series earlier, that just a small fraction of what we eat in Tucson comes from Arizona, about 2% of the food we eat here in Tucson right now, 2-2.5%. Some of you may be up to 4%, but you know, we have a long way to go. The point is that towns like Burlington, Vermont, have set goals like 10-15% of their local diet will be from foods within their county or within a three-county area, and we can do the same thing. But at the same time, we have to understand all the food that comes in across the border and how that affects ecosystems, human health, and even the immigration issue by the way we source our food here. You could say that our hands are bloodied by the way we access our food now, despite the good work that border produce brokers are doing to set up a variety of programs of fair trade and workers' benefits and better working conditions on farms and ranches in Mexico. There's still a lot of collateral damage from the way we source our food from across the border, and that's no one's fault. I'm not blaming anyone. We just have to work on solving those problems, not just the local problems. Nogales itself is the largest inland port of entry for food in the world, and the third largest one in the United States, and it's an incredible example of a learning lab that we can teach people about local and international at the same time. And so the same is true with all our other food streams and the waste streams associated with them. About 50% of the food produced in fields is wasted by the time some of it gets to our plate. And ironically, as William Rathje pointed out with the garbage project 20 years ago in Tucson, we were the hub for garbage studies here, by the way, in the whole world. Most of that food, spoiled food, is after it hits the grocery store. That households waste a larger percentage of the food than the farmers or the truckers or the border produce brokers do. And we're trying to work with composters and methane digesters and other options to make sure that food and its caloric value is not wasted from any of these streams. At the same time, we need to better document what culinary traditions are in our midst. And how many of you went to Tucson Meet Yourself a couple weeks back and saw that extraordinary expression of the ethnic culinary diversity of our own town. I am floored every time I go there. There's more ethnic groups in Tucson than I think in the United Nations. We have this incredible reservoir of traditional knowledge to draw upon and celebrate here. And one way to deal with poverty alleviation through this food biodiversity that we have is to use it to attract local investments, to have the people in this room say, we want a better food system, and we're willing to invest our money not in Wall Street, but locally through alternative financing mechanisms that may provide me, for with the first few years, a smaller return on my investment with lower interest rates of loans given locally. But why is not every credit union and bank in Tucson having its priority an investment in the food entrepreneurs, the people who want to start micro enterprises, who want to start farms right here in our midst, because the multiplier effect from investing locally rather than inviting in chain grocery stores or drive-ins is 20 to 50 times greater than if we let more Walmarts and more McDonald's take over and dominate our food system here. So I'm on the National Board of Slow Money. We're having our next meeting at the Wendell Berry Center in Kentucky in about a month, and we're doing for the first time a four-day food financing boot camp, much like the conservation financing boot camps at Stanford and Yale do to help people with conservation land acquisitions. We're trying to help the food micro-enterprise entrepreneurs find alternative means of funding to put good food in the mouths of their neighbors while gaining livable wages for themselves. To do that, we have to break down what's been called by Patty Limerick the urban-rural divide that has plagued the West really since World War II, if not before. We've had the largest urban migration to any region in the world occur since World War II with Sunbelt urban development. And many of those people have lost touch with their rural roots. They may be from Minnesota or something, and they come down here, and then because they're unfamiliar with the desert and, you know, everything else in our environment, a lot of those people, you know, try to go ice fishing in the Santa Cruz and end up drowning and things like that. So we have to help each other out, old timers and new timers, urban and rural. And the best way to do that is through these farmers markets and these dialogues, like this lecture series, to put rural people and their needs back in front of urban innovators and vice versa. Rural innovators helping people that want to do urban gardening and farming. And this has really happened in a beautiful way due to the recent conferences we've had, Closing the Hunger Gap, that the Food Bank and the Institute for Environment and other groups sponsored, the Border Food Summit that we had a few years ago in Rio Rico. And so now we have a dialogue with people that used to think of each other as adversaries, and that's what this Stitching the West Back Together book that JP mentioned, that Tom Sheridan and I have just worked on with a number of people in this audience, is about. How do we solve that divide and row together in the same direction? Of course, I have to say something about edible Baja, Arizona. It's been the joy of my writing career to be wowed by the incredibly dynamic young writers like Megan Kimball and Rafael de Granada and Laurel Belante and many other people who've stepped up to the plate and just done such awesome reporting about what's happening in our food system. I don't know if you know it, but I helped get the whole edible communities thing off the ground about 6 years ago as an advisor to an extraordinary woman who's now in Santa Fe, Tracy Ryder. And she promised that Tucson would have its own franchise, but during the economic downturn, it just wasn't possible. And then Doug Biggers and Jared McKinley stepped up to the plate. But edible Baja Arizona is now the largest, most frequent, and most paged edible magazine in the country. 275 advertisers and people of all cultures, all walks of life in that. It's really revolutionizing food writing because it's not stereotypic writing. It's telling us what illegal border crossers eat when they're coming north, or what the Border Patrol itself eats when they're wandering around the country, or what food service workers are eating that are in some of the restaurants around here, what issues farmers are facing, like the gorgeously poignant story that Debbie Weingarten wrote about Sleeping Frog and other new farms in the area and what young farmers are going through. So this is an incredible gift that's connecting a lot of us that didn't have a regular means of being connected before. I'm a little biased. It's like my, you know, like my goddaughter or godson. I have to brag about it all the time, but I'm just so excited because I think it's also ramped up more good food writing in the Daily Star and the Tucson Weekly and other things. So there's been a ripple effect of good writing and good reporting because of it. I want to say that there's something really interesting going on that now with Friends of Tucson's birthplace, we're seeing historic preservation, not in a static way, like we're just taking something old and getting it back to the condition that it was in formerly, but we're really doing whole landscape historic preservation here. That's what I see happening as the root of what's going on at Friends of Tucson's birthplace or the Mission Garden. And I'm not disparaging the renovations that happen at Santa Vera Mission, but saying Santa Vera Mission will be complete when the autumn gardens and orchards that were once in that churchyard are back in place. It's not just about buildings. It's about something dynamic and living and vital and changing. And Tuma Cockery has already stepped up to the plate and done that with its Mission Orchard. And I think we're going to see more of it in Tucson's now recognized as a leader in that movement of bringing historic preservation people together with heirloom fruit conservation people with practitioners to bring that fruit into restaurants and festivals and other venues. The other thing that I think has changed is that we see a new generation of foodies that define their universe far differently than the people that used to read Food and Wine and Eating Well. Those magazines still play important roles, but our youth are on board with food justice. As Robert Gottlieb said when he visited us a few years ago, for many of them, food justice and climate justice and immigration justice are all the same issue. That many of the people coming into Tucson now are climate refugees who've lost their farms or orchards in places that have lost their water. And so all of these issues are interacting, and we need to cover them, we need to understand them, and our kids, our students, are really on board with figuring these issues out. And Dignidad y Justicia and other groups in town are really on this with Michael McDonald and Robert Ojeda. We're talking about a interfaith food and hunger conference looking for long-term solutions that we hope to do in the spring or next summer. And so there's a whole different way of looking at the food justice issues in our community than we're used to. And it's the youth that are dragging the rest of us along to have a broader and more ethical perspective on these issues. And the same thing is happening in our civil society. People from many cultures coming together to garden in community gardens. I think we have over 36 community gardens in Tucson now. I may be off by the order of magnitude because they're growing a new one almost every month or every season. But there's a lot of vitality here that we need to understand, document, and then further support. Vanessa Bechtel, who along with Jonathan Mabry and Rafael de Granad, helped put this report that's out on the table out there about our City of Gastronomy nomination has also pioneered the idea of promoting our place-based foods through what's called an eco-label or geographic indicator. Landscape-level branding or marketing or certification for food from a landscape so that farmers and ranchers who are doing the right things on their land are getting consumers to invest in the good deeds that they're doing, so that consumers understand the challenges that ranchers and farmers face and use their buying power to be part of the solutions and support the ranchers who are doing things right. And I think with the Sonoran Desert Conservation Plan, we see that there's an opportunity to use land that's now in the city or county's hands, mostly the county's hands, to help create greater food security in our community. It also means that we have to partner with programs like the incredible culinary arts program at Pima College that my friend Barry Anfuso helped forge, that now has many excellent players in it, to bring culinary arts back to our youth in ways that haven't happened for decades. A lot of the kids who I went to school with didn't know how to cook. They could all burn toast, but that was about it. And now there's young people coming along that are just doing astonishing things. And there's a few in the audience that I won't mention by name to embarrass them, but walk down to Bianco's Pizzeria and watch those guys one night, and you're just going to see magic in motion. The mayor is particularly intent about this notion of diversifying and further promoting our food festivals, because Tucson, Meet Yourself, may now be on the stature of the New Orleans jazz and food festivals, but there's dozens of other food festivals here in town. The International Margarita Contest and Festival, I'll drink to that. Yeah, I mean, we need those things as much as we need the other venues. And when I mean deepen and diversify, Marty Bell and I have been talking about things like talking about the history of the tortilla at a festival where we have Palestinian women who know how to do the Arabic saj, this incredible thing that looks exactly like a Sonoran tortilla this big, sobaquera or tortilla de las aguas, that the origin of our tortilla may lie with Palestinians or Phoenicians who settled coastal Spain and then brought that knowledge and the comal technology with them to Mexico and the Southwest. And juxtaposing women from two very different traditions who are essentially doing the same thing in terms of flinging out a large tortilla and shaping it and showing people the connections between cultures is something we need to do, not just individual demonstrations. Finally, we're back to that thing that none of this matters unless the farmers and the artisans have livable wages, and most of our farm workers do not. Most of the farm workers who we get our food from in Mexico make $7.50 to $10 a day, and they're actually subsidizing, through their work, the food that we deliver in our food banks that comes across the border. Think of that, of people in Mexico making $7.50 a day, finding out that some of their food is being delivered to people from the food bank here in the United States who have 10 to 20 to 30 times more income than they themselves do. So there's some real imperatives in our food system that we have to grapple with. And again, I want to recommend that all of you read Debbie's story in the second or third issue of Edible about what young farming families are going through with no insurance. If a husband falls off a tractor and breaks his back, that's it, they're done for. And so we really have to make sure that the people at the base of our food chain that bring us our daily bread have a safety net. At the same time, it's just as much about creativity and joy. And I don't think anyone has given me as much hope for the future as Haley Thomas, who's not only been featured in Edible Baja Arizona, but is now writing a column for Baja Arizona and has cooked in the White House. Now this woman is extraordinary, but there's probably dozens of other young men and women of her age that are on fire about these things, that we have to find ways of putting them in the, matching them with the right opportunities and mentors to make more magic. In essence, localizing our food shed is a revolutionary act because it changes our relationship with our environment, with our neighbors, and with our future. If we learn how to conserve water now through growing the right crops, our children and grandchildren will have a chance to farm or ranch or raise orchard crops. If we blow it, if we're not constantly innovating and finding ways to better match scarce resources with the right kinds of production, there may not be any options for our children or grandchildren. And the bottom line for me is that we have this incredible wealth of biodiversity, wild biodiversity, and cultivated plant and animal diversity that can enhance our food system, but our goal should be to use that to its highest purpose, and that's poverty alleviation and healing the wounds in our community and in our own bodies. That may take creating more beauty, sensory pleasure, cultural richness. I'm all for that because those sell these incredibly nutritious foods and keep the system working. But we're going to have to learn to use those resources to live well, to live fully, and fully in concert with the place in which we live. And so, however much food comes in from the outside, we have a covenant with the food that's produced here in our midst to do it right, to educate people about how you can grow food in the desert, that it's not too late, or that water is not too scarce to have agriculture here, and that the highest calling for the water that we have here is to improve the health of the people and protect them from the nutrition related diseases that are plaguing nearly half the people in southern Arizona today with adult onset diabetes, cancer, and heart disease. The real irony is that we haven't had much state government investment in this or philanthropic investment in healthy food systems in Arizona compared to our neighbors, California or New Mexico. What has made Arizona's food system change for the better the last 10 years is our entrepreneurial spirit. And I was shocked to learn last summer that Arizona ranks the highest among all states in the United States in the number of microenterprises generated per 10,000 people in a community. We have more entrepreneurial spirit. If you want to call it capitalism, go ahead, call it capitalism. But we have more capacity to do it. Look at the 30 to 50 some businesses that have sprung out of the Mercado de San Agustin community kitchen. That's what's making this system work. And now we have to attract the philanthropic and state government and federal government support to harmonize all of that, because private investment can't do it all. There's some things that have to be done for the public good through philanthropy or through government programs. And we need to say, we're doing what we can with private dollars, come in and complement what's already begun here. So can a designation as a city of gastronomy reap benefits for our children's besides Zantac and Rolaids? I think it can, but we have to keep our eyes on the prize. Because of that, I'd like you to all stand up now and take a pledge, take a vow. This is a participatory part of the program. This is the old Pete Seeger thing, where I'm gonna say a line, and then you're gonna say a line, And this is based on that notion that some of what I affectionately call you old farts in the audience know about, where couples renew their vows after a number of years after being married, you know, some things besides the toast goes stale, and so they need to renew their energy in it. So I'm going to say a line, and then you're going to say a line to renew our vows. Oops, I'll skip those. So this is a vow to sow and reap diversity, and I'm going to say a line, and then you repeat it after me. We as gardeners, farmers, cooks, and eaters, wish to affirm our sacred vows. To take care, love, and serve the astonishing diversity of foods and cultures on this earth. Through sickness and in health. I stole that line. In times of crisis and times of joy. To sow the seeds of food justice. To glean the fruits of food security. To ferment the brews of food democracy. To savor the flavors of true food sovereignty. Through our own actions. And our own eating patterns, so that we may all eat what we have truly sown. We reaffirm our covenant with the earth to humbly be but one more way that seeds themselves. Regenerate into more seeds to nourish all of us. Now go out to love one another, to sow and reap and feast in peace. God bless you. Thank you.